All right, good morning, everyone. How's it going? How's everyone doing? Good? Good? If I haven't met you yet, my name is Pedro. Reverend Pedro. I never say that. I have to say that every once in a while. Just to remind you guys that Reverend. Just kidding. Oh, I am a reverend, but just joking. All right, we have a lot to do today, so we're going to just jump right on in. Today, I want to start off talking about a guy. His name was Charles or Chuck Colson. Does anyone know who that is? Yeah? Oh, John Kelly knows. Anyone else? All right. Well, let me give you a little bit of a bio. Chuck Colson, he died in 2012. He worked for the Nixon administration. His nickname was Richard Nixon's Hatchet Man. And he was also called the evil genius of an evil administration. He started off as a Marine, and after being a Marine, he became a lawyer. And by the age of 37, he was a special counsel to Nixon. Right. So whatever your opinion about Nixon is, he was special counsel to the President of the United States at the age of 37. I am currently 37, and that is a long way away from where I am right now, which is just funny to think about. Colson was the first person in the Nixon administration to go to jail for Watergate. He was sentenced to 1 to 3 years in prison for his convictions were conspiracy and obstruction of justice. And before he went to jail, before his trial really ended in 1973, a friend of his came to him and read a portion of Mere Christianity, specifically about pride, and that moment changed the rest of this man's life. When he was convicted, he was given the opportunity to leave through the courthouse in a different entrance or different exit, one that was less public. And he said no because he wanted to face the press. And on his way out of the courthouse, he said, "I have committed my life to Jesus Christ. I can work for the Lord in prison or out of it." On the way out, he wrote a book in 1983 called Love God. And this is a quote from his book. We have slides for this. He said this, "I know the resurrection is a fact, and Watergate proved it to me. How? Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead. Then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible, right? Number one, okay, takeaway number one from this. God can use absolutely anything to bring people to him. Even this guy who went to jail for Watergate became a Christian out of that season. And he, the very man who went to jail for Nixon, when Nixon didn't even go to jail, he came to faith because of Watergate, because ironically 12 men couldn't keep their mouths shut. And for 40 years the apostles talked about Jesus, preached to him to everywhere they could go, and never once denied the story of the resurrection of Jesus. Right? We start here today. We're starting a new sermon series, and it's called Speaking Jesus. We'll talk about why in a bit, but I wanted to start with this quote because it's so interesting to me that our faith started with a community of people who just wouldn't stop talking about Jesus. And these people who were just like you and me, if you read the gospel accounts, they were babbling fools at times. They were scared of their shadows at times. They did not get anything that Jesus was doing at times. And these same people, the 11 disciples who became the apostles, and then the whole community that was surrounded Jesus at the time, because it was more than just the 12, but Jesus specifically had those 12 closest to him. They spread faith of Jesus because they wouldn't stop talking about him. Our faith didn't start with the formation of Scripture. Our faith didn't start with some holy man who just had this divine inspiration to write everything. And then from day one, we had those things. And God set it up this way on purpose. His story spread, his fame spread through everyone who lived with him, who witnessed him, who personally knew him. And they just could not stop talking about their friend who became their Lord Jesus. Right? So interesting. So interesting that Christianity spreads in the ancient world through this community of people who would not stop talking about him. And that after the life of the 12 apostles, the 11 apostles, it still spread. Right? It would be one thing if it spread during their life. How many movements start with a charismatic leader and die shortly after because that charismatic leader can't keep this movement up? After even Jesus died, his word spread. And then after his own apostles died, the word continued to spread. And for 2,000 years now, the story of Jesus has been the most famous, the most impactful, the most debated, and also the most maligned story in human history. And the story continues to this day because these people wouldn't stop talking about their faith in this man who was also their God. The reason why we are doing this sermon series now is because a few weeks ago I did a sort of altar call here after our last sermon series that was Hearing God. And I invited people to come up and say, if you want to move towards speaking about him, then come up and we'll pray. Because our faith isn't really alive if we're not talking about it. We're going to talk about that a little bit today. But today is an answer to that call. We don't just expect you guys to go out and do this now, but as a church, in the life of our church, we're going to spend a significant portion of this year, the next 10 weeks, in talking about speaking Jesus, talking about our faith in him. We're going to spend time, one, realizing that it is the most natural thing for the believer, for a Christian, to talk about Jesus, because what else is more important than to you than your faith in Jesus? And number two, that the Holy Spirit always empowers those who speak about him. Right? You're not alone. You're not doing it by yourself. The same Spirit that turned the disciples into the apostles is at work in us and alive today. So here's a couple of informational pieces about starting off right in this sermon series. Number one is that we are going to take a 10-week, well, 9 more weeks, look through Acts, the book of Acts, to specifically look at people, instances in the early church, right? Acts is the first book in the Bible after the Gospels, and it documents how the church began here. Like the early days, the baby church finding its way, the first Acts of the church recorded in the book of Acts. And we're going to look through Acts to look at specific examples of not like actual stories of people talking about their faith in Jesus. And we're going to look at those specific examples and we're going to say, what was said? What were they saying about Jesus? What happened when they talked about Jesus? What did the Spirit do when that happened? And how did people respond? Right? If we're talking about Jesus, we're going to look at the time in the Bible where it's happening the clearest. And we're going to say, these things happen when we go out to spread the story of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That Jesus claimed to be God and proved it and came back from the dead, and his followers live out his teachings and tell everyone what he was like. What did these people say? What happened when they said it? And what it means for our lives today? This is going to be preached in the same heart of our preaching theme for the year, which is called normalizing. We're normalizing three things in the life of our church. If City Life is your church, we're spending this year making normal, making plain three things: hearing God, because the believer is made to hear God. All people are meant to hear God's voice. And then number two, speaking Jesus. It is the most natural thing for a Christian to talk about Jesus, because the most natural thing about who a Christian is that Jesus has saved them. is that they are his servants. And like we've talked about in the last couple of weeks, his stewards, entrusted to carry out the master's wish. And then experiencing the Holy Spirit, which will be throughout all of our sermon series, but we'll take a look at also specifically later this year. An organic, lived-in approach of how do we share our faith in normal everyday life. There are some high, holy, divine appointment moments in our lives, and if you find those, you are find a good thing, but by and large, telling people about Jesus is the most natural thing. How can somebody know me and not know that I'm a follower of Jesus if I think that's the most important thing about me? How does it not just flow out of me from time to time? How do I not be intentional? Like, I really want to tell this person about my faith because it's the most natural, central, foundational thing about who I am. More important than anything else that I could ever use to describe who I am, the first thing is I follow Jesus, that he has my whole life. In the same vein of our last sermon series, we talked about hearing God, right? And we said, you listen to those you love. For this sermon series, we're going to talk about this phrase. We talk about what we love. Right? Who here doesn't talk about what they love in life? Who here finds it a burden or a challenge to talk about what you're so passionate about? Every one of us talks about things that we love. I know that Harrison loves movies. You go to the movie theater all the time and you talk about movies all the time. That's like one of the biggest things I know about you because you just love it, right? You just absolutely love doing that. We talk about going to the movies. We talk about shows that we watch. We talk about restaurants. We talk about relationships, new and old. We talk about hobbies and traveling. We talk about new jobs and good news. We talk about all things that matter to us. And so talking about Jesus is the most natural thing about me. It should be the easiest thing for me, not because I have it all figured out, but because it's what I love most. Right? You love about what you talk about what you love. And it's easy to do that because you love it. So normally when we do a bigger sermon series, we have pillars, things that these sermon series are built upon, statements or doctrines or stuff like that to just make it clear. And we bring them up from time to time. And so I wanted to share six pillars when we start today about what this sermon series is built on top of. And the first one is this. We speak Jesus because God is the God who speaks. Right? This should sound familiar from our last sermon series. Everything we do is rooted in who God is and what he does. And the story of the Bible is that there is this God who speaks, and he made us to do the same. Right? We speak because he speaks. He's a talking God. Yahweh, the God of the Bible, he talks. And we follow suit. He made us to do that same thing. And so the question is, what are we doing with our words? And how are we talking about the kingdom with them? Our God is a God who speaks, and he made us to do the same. That's the first thing. The second thing is that Jesus told people who he is, right? Not just who he was, who he is. He did this through his activities, all of them, but specifically healing and forgiving sins, right? Him healing the leper is special because only God heals lepers. Him healing the deaf is special because the Messiah was going to heal the deaf. We talked about that last. He showed us that he was the Messiah by what he did. He also did this from time to time, usually mostly metaphorically. Just in the book of John, 7 I am statements, right, that aren't the way that we as modern people like to hear. Like, he didn't sit down and say, oh, I'm God all the time, right? Everything he said, though, was him telling people who he was. In the book of John, I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the door. I am the gate, right? Very clear in Jewish culture. He was claiming who he was all the time, and it just might be a little bit metaphorical for us, and it might be what some opponents to Christianity point out. It's like, oh, he didn't say he was God all the time. He did in everything that he did. It just looks a little differently, right? It just takes a little bit of work for us to understand some of their culture. But then also, he's told us who he is plainly at least 2 times. Today we're going to talk about one of those times. It's going to be the only week we're not in the book of Acts. We're going to be in John 4 today. But also just to read one other one in John 8:58, when talking to a group of Jewish people, he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." Right? Invoking the name of the I Am Yahweh all the way back from Moses. And the people understood plainly what he was saying here, because the next verse is that they pick up stones to stone him. They knew what he was saying. He said this to us by the way he lived his life, metaphorical in his teachings, but then also sometimes very plainly. He told us who he is. Let's listen to what he says. The third pillar of our sermon series is that Jesus charged all who followed him to speak. Right? All those who belong to him have a charge to speak about him. Everyone, every single person, no matter if you think you're eloquent enough, if you know enough, if you're dedicated enough, if you're a good representative of the Christian life or not, if you are his, you have a charge to speak. Acts, I'll put all this in the sermon notes so you can interact with them, but Acts 1, he says this, "So when he had come together, they asked him," this is after his resurrection, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not time for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority." Verse 8, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." This is just one of our three great commission texts, John 20, Matthew 28. All Jesus charging those who would come after him, who belong to him. You have a charge. And it's to speak about Jesus and spread the gospel and baptize all the world into believing in Jesus, all who will listen and all who will accept Jesus and confess with their mouths. And so we talk about speaking about Jesus because that's what he told us to do. That's the church's mission, to know Christ, to love him, to prepare for his coming, and to bring people into faith. That's what we're commissioned to do. The fourth pillar, speaking and doing go hand in hand. Right? In this sermon series, we're going to talk about how just doing isn't enough. Just speaking isn't enough. Doing and speaking go hand to hand. Speaking without doing is meaningless and untrustworthy, but then also doing without speaking is insufficient and vague. There's a phrase in Portuguese in Brazil, it says, "Uma mão lava o outro, e as duas lavam o rosto." That means one hand washes the other, but together both wash the face. These two can't be separated. Doing and speaking go together. And if we miss one of them, we're missing part of the picture. Doing isn't enough. If you're someone who says, "I'll just show people that I follow him," that's great. That's not enough. And if you're someone who says, "Oh, I yell at people about Jesus all the time," that's not great. But I'm glad you're talking, all right? So we need both. Pillar number 5, it's always right to say something about Jesus. And I want to be sensitive on this one, because discerning timing is a real thing. It is really valuable to be someone who discerns when it's the right time to say everything and when you should hold off, right? But I wanted to make this a pillar because I almost never hear stories here where it's like, "Oh, the Holy Spirit was so on me and I just went for it. I didn't know if it was the right time or not, I just went for it." I almost only always hear, "It just wasn't the right time. I didn't know, so I just like, I'll save it for next time." We might not know when we have next times with people. And even if you don't present the whole gospel message to someone, every single time you talk to them, it is always good to say something about faith in Jesus. It is always right, appropriate, when it's time to talk about Jesus. If the person doesn't like it and if they don't receive it, it still does not make it the wrong time to tell someone about who Christ is. One of the things we're going to look at in Acts is the immediacy of people coming to faith. When people talked, They came to believe on the spot, and they were baptized in the same hour. Like, oh, we make it a 5-month course. We wait a whole year before we ever invite anyone into faith, right? Maybe we need to speed this up a little bit, empowered by the Holy Spirit to trust him. It is always right to say something about Jesus. And then our last pillar is, if you can't explain it, you don't get it. All right, when I was going through my ordination process, there would be so many topics that my coach would be like, okay, Pedro, what would you say about X? And I would be like, well, you know, it's like kind of like that thing. And it's like, oh, you know, it's like kind of relates to this. And he's like, Pedro, if you can't clearly tell me, you don't know it. You need to spruce up on this. If you cannot explain faith in your faith in Jesus, you don't really fully get it. And so we're going to spend time preparing how do we talk about Jesus, because if we can't tell, what my old pastor used to say, if you can't tell a child what you're trying to say, you don't know what you're trying to say. And so we're going to learn about how do we talk about Jesus. So these are our pillars, and one of the cool things that we're going to do is that over the since January, Wamia, me, Diane, and Carla have gone through an evangelism course with this program in the city called City to City, and with every sermon, there's going to be something practical that we're going to teach. Wamia is going to come up here from time to time. Diane is going to join me here from time to time to explain exercises that we learned, because number one, they're awesome and I want them to do this with us, but because talking about Jesus is normal and practical and awesome and beautiful and what you were made for. Amen? It's going to be cool. All right, so I used up so much time already. We are going to be in John chapter 4. This is going to be the only week we are not looking at a specific example in the book of Acts, but we start in John chapter 4 because we're going to look at an interaction that Jesus started, because you always start with Jesus. Jesus is always the prime example. We are not going to look at Paul or Peter or anyone else talking about who Jesus is before we talk about when Jesus approached a Samaritan woman at the well and plainly told her who he was to see what happened. And so let's read in John chapter 4. If you could stand for the reading of God's word, just as a sign of respect and reverence, we're going to be reading starting in verse 3. It's a little bit long, so I'm going to ignore some punctuations. Just deal with me. This is the word of the Lord. It says this, starting in verse 3. He left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field of Jacob, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journeys, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" For Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Verse 16, Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had 5 husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I am. I who speak to you am he. Then the disciples came back, and the story continues. Let me pray real quick. Lord, I thank you for this day. And I pray that you would be with me to preach your word faithfully, to talk about this instance where you very clearly told someone of who you are, for us to see how that went, for you to teach us how to do the same. And Lord, I thank you. Thank you for keeping us. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Feel free to take a seat. All right, so unfortunately, we are not going to be able to unpack all of this because this story is so good. There's a reason why the church throughout the millennia has been so attracted to this story. This is one of the better known stories of the Gospels. Yeah, tons of people who are not Christians know this story, and it's because this story is pretty famous for reasons people like and for reasons some don't. But let me give you some key context points for us to understand a deeper side of what's happening here. The first thing that I'll point out is that Jesus is traveling through Samaria, a portion of the land that would have otherwise been ignored and walked around, but we'll get to more of that in a second. The second is that Jesus goes to Jacob's well, which is super important, the setting, and that Jesus goes there and he sits on it. The third one is that Jesus was tired. This story is such a beautiful glimpse of Jesus' humanity and his divinity working at the same time, hand in hand. It is elegant and gorgeous. And then the last one is that it says that it's about the sixth hour. So let's break this down a little bit. I have a map here, if we can show the map, of Jesus' route. He is going from the bottom, which is Jerusalem, and he's trying to go to where the circle is. That's the region of Galilee. But in the day, there was this group of people called the Samaritans who lived in Samaria in between them, and the Samaritans were hated by the Jews. They were hated uniquely and specially by the Jews because they were seen as less than human. Because the Samaritans used to be full-blooded Jews, but then during the Assyrian conquest in about 722 BC, the Assyria brought in foreigners and they intermarried during that time, which was one of the biggest no-nos for a Jew back then. And so they were seen as less than human because they weren't Jews. They were like less than Jews. They were even less than other people because they were seen as subhuman, right? Kind of like us, but also not like us, corrupted. And so they had a tense relationship, almost no relationship. And any self-respecting Jew who was in Jerusalem or in the southern part of Judah who wanted to go to Galilee, instead of going through Samaria, would go around it, adding a very long time to their voyage. But if you were a self-respecting Jew, you would never be caught in Samaria. Jesus obviously ignores this and goes straight through Samaria because he has this appointment with this woman at the well. Super important, super compassionate that Jesus would do this to meet a Samaritan. We'll see why in a second. The other part of this is that he ends up at Jacob's well. And one of this woman's biggest questions is, are you better than Jacob? right? Jacob, he's one of the big G's, right? He's one of the old guys. He's one of the ones who is named in the lineage of God, of Jesus, right? He's like one of the big dogs. And she's like, are you better than Jacob? And she's sitting at this well here, not knowing that not only is she with the one who is, greater than Jacob, she's with the one who made Jacob. He's with the one who made those stones that the well is made out of. He's the one who spoke everything into being. And she doesn't know it yet, but she's about to find out who it is that is this man who's talking to her, right? She didn't know if he was bigger, better than Jacob. He's way better, and that's the whole point of this story. And then the next is that Jesus was tired. Such a beautiful example of the man that Jesus was, a real person. Theologically, this is so significant. Jesus wasn't here pretending. He wasn't a ghost. He put on humanity like you and me, and he was wearied from his travel. He was thirsty. He gets at this well. He sends his disciples away to get some food because he's probably just done with them at that moment. He's like, go get the food. Leave me alone for a second. And he sits there, and we see Jesus's humanity, right? That he came here to save us as God and as human. Second Adam theology, so important that he redeemed us as one of us as well. Beautiful. This woman gets to see a special side of Jesus that is incredible. Beautiful. That Jesus would allow himself to ever be this vulnerable is a sign of his compassion and his generosity towards us. And then it's also important that this story takes place at about the sixth hour. The sixth hour of the day was noontime. And the reason why this is important is because all the women would get the well, and they would do this in the early portions of the morning. No one would be going there at the hottest point of the day because it wasn't in the town. You had to lug these jars. You had to lug them back. It makes no sense that she would be there at noon unless she was not allowed to be there when all the other women were there. Not only did Jesus had an appointment in Samaria, he went there, he was tired. He went to go meet a woman there, a Samaritan woman, and not only that, she was, as we will see, a lady with a reputation, a lady who has stolen a few husbands, a lady who is not welcomed when all of the other ladies are there to get their water, right? This is the most unlikeliest meetings of all time. This is such a picture of Jesus's humanity and his divinity working at the same time. Because none of this from a human perspective makes sense. None of this from a self-respecting Jewish man makes sense. This is Jesus knew, and in this story we see his divine appointment going hand in hand with his humanity. This story is absolutely gorgeous in every way. So let's talk about the exchange. Jesus meets her and he starts talking with her, and he asks her for some water, and she says, why are you asking me this? And in verse 10, he says, if you knew the gift of God, who is it that is saying to you, give me water, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Right, this is a phrase that we've made hyper-spiritual, and we don't really understand what it is. We just know it's special. It's this water. Jesus says, hey, if you ask me for water, I can give you living water. And we know that's special, but we don't know what that means. The literal picture of this in the Jewish world, anything, any body of water that's moving is considered living water. Right, it's not a puddle that stays on the ground or a dirty pond or a swamp that never moves and mosquitoes grow in and bacteria grow in. Everyone would have known that those standing still waters were gross. Living water was any spring or any lake, any river that is flowing, that is not sitting still. It's water that is always on the move and always being replenished because it's coming from somewhere, right? And so the spiritual lesson in this living water is that Jesus is saying, I'll give you water that never runs out. I'll give you water that is always fresh. It's not dirty, and it's not disgusting. It's not smelly. It's not any of these things. It's this water that is always rushing, and it's always fresh, and it's always cool, and it's coming, and it never runs out. Jesus is saying, if you knew who I was, you wouldn't have to come to this well every day, you would have such water, rushing water, water that is alive, movement inside of who you are, that you would be satisfied. The physical picture is he's saying, I'll give you water that is always rushing. But what he's saying is, if you trust me and if you take my water, you're never going to be thirsty. You're always going to have enough. You're always going to be refreshed. You're always going to have this life rushing in you. It's so beautiful. And Jesus goes to a Samaritan woman and he offers it to her. Right? This, if it was anyone but Jesus, would never have happened. And anyone who does stuff like this today is just copying what Jesus did, because he's the most generous person, goes to the least likely person. Right? He's this good shepherd who goes after the one and leaves the 99. He knew he was meeting this woman and had an appointment with her and didn't care about what was in his way to get there. And so we see this. And he says, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty. He's saying about the water in the well. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never thirst again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Right? He's saying that the water that Jesus gives, not only is it just always going to refresh you, but it's also going to create that spring inside of you. Right? You're going to always carry that spring, and you're going to take that refreshment everywhere that you go, all the way into eternal life, because that's what Jesus does. That's what his name does. And he's like, how does this sound to you? Water that never spoils, that always satisfies, that is always refreshing. And she says in verse 15, sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or come here again. And then something interesting happens. Jesus asks her to go and get her husband and to bring him back, because he knows who she is. He knows who his divine appointment was with. He knows what she's caught in. And there's a lot to be said there. She asks this deflecting question about where to worship, right? She's talking about this fight between the Jews and the Samaritans, because the Samaritans worshiped somewhere else, and the Jews were like, no, you have to worship in Jerusalem. And she asks this question to just kind of take the spotlight off of her, I believe, because she asks this question about something out there, but Jesus is like, no, I want to talk about you. He answers that question, and then he gets back to talking to her, because he is there to meet her. And one of the most important parts of this whole story is that in verse 25 she says, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Right? Super important. Her criteria of knowing when the Messiah was here was that she would meet, or they would meet, the one who could know all things. Right? Not a coincidence that Jesus talks about, go and get your husband. He knew that. And he would have not known that any other way than this divine appointment. And he blatantly goes out to her. And in one of the clearest examples in all of the Gospels of Jesus directly telling someone who he was, interesting that he did not say this to a Jew. He saved this for a Samaritan woman, a loose Samaritan woman, and he tells her exactly who he is. He's like, that one that you're talking about, that's me. Let's not get confused in this. That is me. And he talks to her. He talks to her about her situation. He's showing her, I know you. My daughter, I know you. I know that you are here at noon for a reason. I came here at noon to meet you because I know your secrets. I know what's happening inside. I know you. And he does this to satisfy her criteria. He tells her what she keeps secret. He tells her, the stranger, that he knows that she is with this fifth guy, and that he is not her husband, and that she is there at noon for a reason, because the other ladies don't let her be there when everyone else is there. And in that moment, her response is this, verse 28 and 29. So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, come and see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? Right? She said to him, the Messiah who is coming will know everything. Jesus told her everything, and she leaves. And the thing that was her shame became her victory cry of meeting the Messiah. Her response to Jesus is, this guy knows everything. I found him. Is he the Messiah? Because he just told me what I, don't tell anyone. He just told me my biggest shame. He told me what keeps me trapped in guilt. He told me all of this, and I told him that the Messiah would know everything, and he knew this. And she leaves, she goes to town, and the woman who is rejected by everyone hears about Jesus because they know her, and she met someone who also did. And she runs around town telling everyone of who Jesus is and what he did, that he is the one who could tell her everything. And a lot of people believe. The story continues. I want to read from verse 39. Many Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. And this is her testimony. He told me all that I ever did. Verse 40. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. And they said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves. We know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. Right? This lady who's like, the Messiah is going to know everything. Jesus tells her everything, including who he is, plainly, clearly, boldly, in a way that he didn't with the Jews. He reserved for the Samaritan woman. And she goes around town and says, you know, the thing that we all know about me, right? That brings people to Christ. That brings people to salvation in Jesus. That brings many more to come and believe. And so what do we do with this story for our first week in our sermon series? Number one, we got to tell people plainly who we think Jesus is. Jesus told her plainly, that person who you're talking about, I'm him. That's me. And then he told her everything that she was keeping secret. He told her her shame and her guilt. And she came to believe. And not only did she come to believe, but that shame and that guilt is what opened the door for other people to find Jesus for themselves. Jesus stayed 2 extra days in a place that he should not have ever been in the first place. And people found him when he told them who he was. And so, the place that we start this sermon series is a clear reminder that we are not necessarily called to share our doctrine, though that's good and we should. We are not only called to tell people why they're wrong, though there is room for that. That's not the whole message. What you go when you speak to people about your faith is you give them Jesus. Before strategy, formula, before anything else, your story is Jesus himself, the man. You look at the Gospels and you look at what happened after he came, and what you're charged to do is tell people who Jesus is. To meet people in their shame and in their guilt and in their trap, in their sin, in all things that hold them down, and you tell them that Jesus brings them living water, they will find it for themselves if there are people who are searching for help. The Holy Spirit is a part of this journey. The story you share is Jesus, right? That's the story that you are charged to tell, is to tell people who he was. There's room for doctrine. There's room for theology. There's room for our catechisms. There's room for all of these different things. There's room for all of that, but don't stop remembering that the number one thing to tell people is who Jesus is and what he's like, and that he is perfect in love, and that if you just confess his lordship after you hear his story, you're forgiven and at peace with him. And so as we are moving, worship team can come up, as we are moving towards this whole sermon series, We're spending the next 9 weeks talking about speaking Jesus. Every week we come back, and the first thing we're reminded of is what we share is the man who saved us, Jesus. That's what we are in charge over doing. And so right now we're going to worship him a bit, and then I'll come and I'll close us off. So real quick, if you're here and you don't call yourself a Christian, let me just say that it is always the right moment to put your life and faith in him. It is always the right moment to confess with your life and with your heart, with your mouth, of who he is. If you need to hear more, let's talk about more, but it is always the right moment to accept Jesus into your life, because he is the one who is better than Jacob. He is the one who does have the living water, and he is who everyone in this planet has been made by and for. It is always the right time to put your faith in Jesus. We can talk about that even today. Come talk. And then for the Christians, when you talk about Jesus, you are talking to someone who was made by him and someone who is waiting for him, for his living water, because he is better than Jacob. He made Jacob. He made every single person. And so in these weeks, we're going to talk about speaking Jesus, because that's what we're made for. That's what we've been commissioned to do. And that is the joy of our lives, to talk about the one that we love more than anything. And so let me pray for us really quick. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for keeping every single one of us here today. And Lord, as we start this talk, this sermon series in the life of our church, Lord, may you be working in us, preparing us to tell people about the gospel, that we would come into further conviction of who you are and what you do and what you offer. And our love for you. And Lord, I pray for divine appointments to come up in these 10 weeks. I pray for you to bring that to every single one of us, for you to be challenging us of where we view you too little or ourselves too little. But Spirit, equip us to be people who love you first and then talk to people about who you are. Thank you. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, everyone. Love you. Thanks for being here. See you.